सर ऑडिबल सर.
You are audible and visible. Please carry on.
So in this presentation, I will tell about the parts and functioning of a mechanical ventilator. The objectives of my presentation would be what are the parts of the ventilator, how does a ventilator actually function, and about the ventilator circuit, what are the components of the circuit, humidification, how the humidification is done, and troubleshooting for problems in the ventilator and the humidifier. Basically, any ventilator has two components. It is the hardware part and the software part. The hardware part includes power, gases, the blenders which mix the gases, the valve assemblies which regulate the pressures, and the sensors which sense the flow, pressure, volume, and FiO2. Similarly, the software part, which I will not be dealing in this presentation, but they include mechanisms for triggering, for controlling, and for cycling. And algorithms which measure tidal volume, compliance, resistance, leaks, and which also sense apnea. And we also have feedback based adjustments like volume guarantee modes and leak compensations, etc. These are all parts of the software of the ventilator. So today's presentation is primarily based on the hardware of the ventilator. So coming to the parts of the ventilator, the first part, as I told, it was the inputs. The inputs will be the gas and power. The gas inlet, typically all the ventilators have an air and oxygen port which delivers the gases, and they enter the mixing tank or blender, and from there gases are connected to the inspiratory tube. So when the gases come from the central supply, initially they are filtered for any particulate material using filters, air filters. And to make the flow unidirectional, that is to prevent backflow of the air, there will be non-return valves. And to regulate the flow and hence the pressure, because flow and pressure are completely interrelated. So flow, pressure, and volume, all these are regulated by the control valves. So these non-return and control valves are actually solenoid valves, which I will be discussing in the later part of the presentation. Once the proportions of air and oxygen enter the mixing tank, then the flow from the mixing tank to the inspiratory limb is regulated by a mixed gas metering valve. So all these are regulated by the software of the computer. The commands are given by the person. The inspiratory unit, beyond the regulatory valve, we have one more safety valve to regulate the flow of the gases into the inspiratory limb. Some ventilators have emergency expiratory valve in case the expiratory valve becomes dysfunctional. The patient can exhale through this emergency valve, and there can also be emergency breathing valve in case the inspiratory limb fails, or the proximal portion of the inspiratory limb and the inlets fail. The patient may breathe through the emergency breathing valve. These may not be there in all the ventilators in the inspiratory limb. Their location may be different. And an expiratory limb typically has an air filter. Before the gases, exhaled gases enter the patient, they are filtered by the expiratory filter, mainly for the bacterial content. And we have a PEEP valve, which is again a solenoid valve, which I will be discussing in the coming slides. And where, this is where the PEEP is actually regulated. Then there will also be a non-return valve to maintain the unidirectional flow. And we also have a flow sensor. So when these are all put together, that makes the hardware of the ventilator. But in addition, we also need sensors, like how to regulate the flow, how to sense the flow, and the FiO2. So we have an oxygen sensor in the inspiratory limb, in the inspiratory part, which senses the oxygen. And we also have pressure calibration valves and pressure sensors, which sense pressure in the inspiratory and expiratory limb. So in this video, I will be showing you the parts of the mechanical.
Hello everyone. In this video, we will be showing you parts of the mechanical ventilator. For the purpose of demonstration, we are using Accutronic ventilator from the Fabian. We are not promoting any ventilator, only for the purpose of demonstration. Basically, a ventilator has four components. One is the inlets, which includes the gases and the electricity. Then the inspiratory unit, where the mixing of air happens and the gases are delivered to the patient. This is followed by an expiratory component, where exhaled gases are collected. And we have an assembly, which senses the pressures and the oxygen. So I will show you in detail all these components in the following demonstration. So I will be showing you the components of the ventilator, the entry and exit points. So this is the backside panel of the ventilator, where we have the power entry point for AC current, which takes a 220 volts input. And we also have a connection for DC current, which can be used. It is optional. These are the power inputs. This is followed by gas inputs. One is for oxygen and one is for air. The oxygen tubing is always white in color and the air tubing is black in color. This is a filter which can be used, which is used for the air port. This is because the centralized supply of air has some amount of humidity, and the humid gases can be damaging to the ventilator, and the air enters into this filter and it is trapped by the water trap. If you want to release the water which has accumulated, you can press on this screw. And we also have a port for flow sensor, for carbon dioxide sensor, and this is a port for ultrasonic nebulizer. And we also have ports for SPO2 sensor, which we can be used as a feedback control one. And this is the VGA port and this is the network port for data connectivity. This is the fan and this is the alarm. This is the front part of the ventilator, which has four important ports and a screen. The first port, the blue one, it is the inspiratory port. Inspiratory gases exit from this port, then enter the humidifier, then reach the patient. This is the prox port, where we attach a pressure sensor. And this is the expiratory port. The exhaled gases enter into this port. This is for high frequency ventilation. Whenever a baby is on high frequency ventilation, this is attached to the inspiratory circuit, which I will be showing in the circuit demonstration. This is the blender assembly of the ventilator. We have opened up the sidewall of the ventilator. Once the oxygen and air, before they enter the blender assembly, there are filters located in the tubings. This is how a filter looks like. They filter out the particulate material. This is the oxygen tubing and this is the air tubing. So there are important valves which are there in the blender assembly. This is the pressure regulator. We have a pay reach for oxygen and air. And these are the solenoid valves and these are proportionate valves. What happens is the air enters the blender assembly at a central pressure of 4 to 6 atmospheres. These two valves, they drop the pressure. And this is the pressure sensor. Whenever the pressure is inadequate, which happens when the central supply is not properly connected, they alert the physician by giving an alarm. The solenoid valves and proportionate valves are an important component. They regulate the precise amount of oxygen and air to be delivered. The inspiratory gas, the mixed gas, the oxygen levels are sensed by the oxygen cell. Following this, the gas enters the inspiratory tubings. The inspiratory gases, which come through the red tube, enter the inspiratory limb of the patient circuit. This is the pressure sensor, and it is connected to the proximal port through a green tubing. And inside we have two safety valves. I will also explain the parts of a ventilator circuit. We are showing this demonstration on Fisher and Paykel circuit. So this is the humidifier base, which is connected to the power supply. And this is the humidifier chamber. The blue ones are the inspiratory limbs. This is the expiratory limb. This is the Y piece connecting inspiratory and expiratory limb. This is the flow sensor and this is the pressure sensor. We also have two wires. This is the temperature sensor, which is again attached to the inspiratory limb. And this is the heater wire adapter. To insert the humidifier chamber onto the humidifier base, we have to press this blue bar. Then this has to be carefully inserted. And once it is locked, we can hear the click. The inspiratory limb has two components. The first component carries the inspiratory air from the ventilator to the humidifier chamber. This is the second part of the inspiratory limb. It has two ports for temperature sensor, which I will be attaching and showing. This part will be attached to the humidifier. This is the expiratory limb, which can be attached to the expiratory port. The inspiratory and expiratory limbs are connected through the Y piece. To the Y piece, we attach the flow sensor. The proximal line will be attached to the port provided in the expiratory limb, and the other end is attached to the proximal port of the ventilator. There are two temperature sensors. This is the distal temperature sensor and this is the proximal temperature sensor. The distal temperature sensor is attached to the end of the inspiratory limb. And the proximal sensor is attached to the beginning of the inspiratory limb. The port for temperature sensor on the humidifier is color-coded. This is the heater adapter. It has three components. The yellow color-coded one will be attached to the humidifier base. The butterfly-shaped one will be attached to the inspiratory limb. And the other one will be attached to the expiratory limb. The yellow color-coded end will be attached to the humidifier chamber. The butterfly-shaped one will be attached to the inspiratory limb. And the other end will be attached to the expiratory limb. This is the water inlet for the humidifier chamber and it has to be always connected to a distilled water chamber. So this is the maximum water level which is indicated by the blue colored line and the arrow. Once the water is filled up to that level, it is automatically cut off by using a valve.
So I will discuss about the pressure generation now. There are two techniques by which pressure is generated. Pressure, we see the physics formula, pressure is the product of flow and resistance. So either by increasing the gas flow or by increasing the gas resistance to gas flow, we can increase the pressure. For most modern ventilators, they use a combination of both. That is, they increase the flow and they also increase the resistance to increase the pressure. So this is what I was telling about, a solenoid valve. And this is the valve assembly, which is regulated by the computer, the software of the computer. So the gas enters the valve assembly through the coiled spring. It leaves from the diaphragm. So when we want to increase the pressure and when we give a command, what actually happens is the spring compresses and the orifice from which the gas exits, it actually becomes smaller. So as the orifice becomes smaller, the resistance to the gas flow increases and this results in increased pressure. So these can be very precisely regulated, these solenoid valves. That is the reason why they are used in all the ventilators. But there are other types of valves also which can provide this PWP. They include fixed diaphragm valves, which are the older version, which are seldom used nowadays, and adjustable spring valves. This we can see in the peep valves of the ambu bags. Some ambu bags have peep valves where they are mostly based on the adjustable spring valves. And we also have a bubble CPAP where the pressure is regulated by the depth of insertion of the expiratory limb into the water chamber. So the patient will be exhaling against the depth of insertion. The depth of insertion is nothing but PWP. So I will tell brief about the sensing systems. For flow sensing, various methods used are screen pneumotachographs. What they actually do is they sense the pressure drop. So the gas flows across small bore tubules. As the gas crosses, there will be some drop in the pressure because as the gas enters the small bore tubules, the pressure increases. As it leaves, because the space, the cross section increases, the pressure drops. This drop is sensed by the differential pressure transducers and the processor will give us the flow. The other methods are orifice flow meters. They can be fixed or variable. These are commonly used in neonatal ventilators. When the gas flows, what happens is it generates some pressure on the valve here. So there will be an orifice which is created and it is proportionate to the amount of gas flow. And if the gas flows in the reverse direction, it actually goes in the reverse direction. So it can sense both the flow in both the directions. Depending on the extent to which this orifice is created, the signals are sent to the flow sensor and this is how the gas is measured. There are also fixed orifice flow meters which are also used. And the other one is hot air anemometer. Again, there is a metal like some tungsten or some other metals. Which are having some temperature. As the gas is flowing across these metal, they result in some fall in temperature. This fall in temperature generates a signal, electrical signal, and this is interpreted as the flow. We also have ultrasonic sensors, where ultrasonic radiations are sent from transducer to transducer across the flow. Depending on the velocity of the flow, the signals actually differ, and this results in flow sensed by the flow sensor. Of these, hot air anemometers and variable orifice flow meters are commonly used in neonatal ventilators. For gas sensing, we have paramagnetic sensors where some electric current is generated because of the flow of the gases, and that is electromagnetic potential is generated, which is sensed by the transducer. We also have galvanic sensors or oxygen cells. Actually, the demonstration which I showed, it is an oxygen cell where a chemical reaction occurs with the air flowing through the sensor and the chemical ingredient. It may be potassium hydroxide. There are some other ingredients also. Again, this generates an electrical gradient, which is sensed by the sensor. So as you see, these become like they expire after a certain hours of use. So we have to be aware. We have to be aware of the time duration for which they can be used. Then we also have polarimetric sensors and infrared absorption spectroscopy for carbon dioxide. I'm not going into details of these two. For pressure sensor, we have age-old aneroid manometers, which are used in older ventilators. And most of the current ventilators, they use variable induction or strain gauge transducers. So as the gas flows across these strain gauge, the spring will stretch, and this generates a electric potential. This is sensed by the ventilator. Variable capacitance transducers are rarely used nowadays. Most of the transducers used are variable inductance transducers. So this is the basics of the sensors, and I'm going into the ventilator function. Basically, a ventilator is a like you can see, there is an inlet for gases and there is an outlet for gases. There is a continuous flow of gas. This is what we call bias gas flow. And this is connected to the breathing circuit through the endotracheal tube to the patient. The flow of the gases is regulated by the PEEP and PIP valves. So when the pressure increases, some amount of gas is diverted into the breathing circuit, which enters the patient. So how actually the pressure changes happen? I have explained to you about the solenoid valve, how it functions, but how it translates into a mechanical ventilator, that I will show you in the following slides. So this is the pressure time scalar of the lung, and this is the pressure time scalar of changes happening in the ventilator circuit. So when we give a command like to generate PEEP, what ventilator actually does is the PEEP valve moves downwards. You can see here the PEEP valve moves downwards. As the PEEP valve moves, the resistance to gas increases. As a result, there will be increased pressure initially in the ventilator circuit, which is transmitted to the breathing circuit and also to the patient's lungs. So simultaneously, you can see there is some expansion of the lung. So there will be some expansion of the lung when you do PEEP. Then coming to PIP, both the valves will have similar mechanism. So when you give a command to generate some PIP, what actually happens in a ventilator is the PIP generator or the PIP valve, it moves ahead. This results in increased pressure in the circuit, which is again transmitted to the limb breathing circuit and to the chest wall. So this is what actually happens. So the pressure is transmitted to the circuit, the pressure is transmitted to the lung, and the lung expands. And when you when the expiration has to begin, there can be various methods by which you can trigger expiration. Whatever is the method, when expiration begins, the PIP generator goes back after the TI is complete. The PIP generator goes back to its baseline position. This results in a drop in pressure in the circuit and the ventilator, and a decrease in the and exhalation happening in the lung. This is how expiration happens. I will show you the entire respiratory cycle in this animation. So there is already baseline PEEP, which is provided. When we give a signal for generation of PIP, there is a movement of the valve, increase in pressure, and expansion of the lung. when the TI is complete, so the lung will stay there till the TI is complete. Once the TI is finished, the PIP valve will move back to its original position. This results in a pressure drop and deflation of the lung or the exhalation process. So this and this, there will be some hold till the expiration is complete before the next respiratory cycle begins. So this is how a pressure generation happens inside the ventilator. And till now I have told you about the pressure changes. I will now show you the flow and volume changes which happen when you, when the ventilator is generating PWP and PIP. So this is the volume time scalar I'm showing for the patient's lung or the breathing circuit. So when PIP is getting generated, there will be some flow, some increase in flow, which will expand the lung. So following this, when a command for PIP is given, because of the increased resistance in the circuit, the flow will be diverted to the breathing circuit. There will not be any change in the gas flow or the bias flow happening in the ventilator. It will remain the same and continuous. But because of increased resistance, the pressure is increased and flow is diverted to the breathing circuit and into the patient's lung. So this is what will actually happen. The pressure will, the flow will increase, the volume will increase, and pressure will increase. Gradually, it decreases. In the expiration, when the TI is complete and the expiration begins, the valve moves outside. There is again a pressure drop. And actually, because the lung pressure will be at a higher level than the resting pressure inside the ventilator, the flow happens in the reverse direction, which you can see here. The flow is happening in the reverse direction, and simultaneously the lung is deflating. So the exhalation is happening. So this is the TE. Till the TE is there, complete, the lung will be in that position. So I will show you the respiratory cycle once again. When you give a command for increasing PIP, the PIP valve generator moves. There will be increased pressure in the circuit. So flow will be directed towards the lower pressure lung. So this results in lung inflation. There will be some hold till inspiration. When you give a command for expiration, the PIP generator moves back. There will be a reverse direction flow because of drop in pressure compared to the lung and exhalation. Similarly, I will show you the volume changes which happen again in the breathing circuit of the lung. So when we give command for PWP, there will be some increase in volume which may not be reflected in your scalar. And when you are generating the, when the ventilator is generating the PIP, the valve moves, there is increase in volume of the lung and the lung expands. So this expansion stays there till the TI is complete. When once the expiration begins, the valve moves out. Because of the pressure and flow in the reverse direction, the volume of the lung decreases. This is what is exhalation. And in a complete respiratory cycle, PIP command, increase in volume, expansion, and stay till completion of TI. You give a command for the TI is finished and this PIP valve will move back. There will be fall in lung volume till the TI is complete. So as Srinivas sir has already discussed about the control, trigger, cycle, and the limit, I will just brief through them. So control is what actually controls a breath. So it is usually pressure or volume control. Other methods like flow control are rarely used. So this is what gives feedback to the ventilator. Like if you set pressure control, the ventilator looks only at the pressure and the other two parameters are regulated based on the pressure. If you set volume, it will focus its complete regulation on the volume. The flow and pressure will be accordingly managed. So I will show you how to identify. So this is the pressure time scalar, flow time scalar, and volume time scalar. So when you see here, only the pressure curve is smooth. The flow is titrated accordingly and volume is also titrated accordingly. In the other side, in the right side, you can see the volume curve is going smoothly, volume time scalar. And the rest pressure and flow are titrated accordingly. Hence, this is the pressure control mode and this is the volume control mode of ventilation. So triggering is what initiates a breath. So usually it is time which is set to initiate the breath. But in spontaneous modes, this time is in mandatory modes. Like you are giving CMV, IMV, invasive mandatory ventilation. The time will be the cycling method, triggering method. But when in the spontaneous modes, it is usually pressure or flow. Sometimes a shape signal can be there. And in the advanced ventilators or advanced technology is using NAVA, neurally adjusted ventilator assist. So in triggering, observe carefully. When the patient tries to take a breath, what happens is there will be some expansion in the lung. So this generates a flow, although in the direction from the circuit to the ventilator, because as the lung is, as the patient is trying to breathe, what happens is the chest wall expands. There will be a negative pressure which is created in the pleural space. Because of this, the pressure inside the lung falls. So there will be flow, which is the bias flow will be diverted to the patient's lung because it is at the negative pressure. So at this time point, the flow will be sensed and a pressure drop can be sensed. So it depends on the type of trigger you are setting. If it is flow trigger or pressure trigger, accordingly it is sensed. Once this is sensed, the feedback goes to the ventilator and it activates the respiratory cycle. So this is what happens. The PAP generator moves towards the PEEP valve. So this results in beginning of the inhalation. So this is what triggering. Triggering is about initiation of a breath. In spontaneous modes, it is flow or pressure trigger. In mandatory modes, we can't call it a trigger, but it is time which regulates the breath, initiation of the breath. So coming,
sir, we have 10 minutes more.
Okay, sir. Coming to the limit or target, this is what limits the breath. Usually what we set are pressure, volume, flow and combinations. But most commonly used thing is the pressure limiting or volume limiting. So I'm showing you volume time scalar, flow time scalar and pressure time scalar. So when you are limiting by pressure, what happens is your PAP generation will continue till the set pressure is reached. So beyond this point, there won't be any rise in the pressure. But because some increase in some flow will be there, the lung volume further increases. So you can see even after the pressure is attained, till the TI is there, some flow will be maintained. This results in further inflation of the lung. Coming to the flow limiting, so the flow will increase till the limit which is set by us. Following this, again, the flow will start decreasing gradually. It will not fall dramatically to zero. So there will be some further lung inflation which is going beyond this. But when you see the volume limiting, so the lung will expand only till the set volume. So once this volume is attained, this marks the end of the inspiratory time. This is different compared to the other modes, other forms of limiting. Then again, there will be sudden drop in flow and decrease, sudden drop in the pressure, and the inhalation ends there. Okay. So cycling. Cycling means what ends a breath. The most commonly used method is flow cycling. In modes like SIMV and assist control, it is time because you set the prefix TI, the breath will cycle according to the TI. But if you choose PSV mode, it is the flow. So I will show you. So this is a time cycling. I will not go in depth of this. I will show you the flow cycling. When the inspiration begins, it is triggered and the PAP generator moves. There will be increase in the flow and the flow starts falling gradually once the pressure is attained. At a certain critical point, which is called termination sensitivity. It is in this graph, you can see it is around 20 to 25%. At this time point, the inspiration ends, exhalation is triggered. It cycles to exhalation and the PIP valves moves out and the exhalation begins. This is how a flow cycling actually happens inside the ventilator. So I will show you about the, like, sir, shall I go to the troubleshooting?
I think better to go for troubleshooting, yeah.
Yeah. So I will tell you about the troubleshooting of various components. Some parts I am skipping. I can share the presentation later. So sometimes we find low FiO2 alarm. This occurs because there is discrepancy between delivered FiO2 and set FiO2. Derived FiO2 is the FiO2 which your oxygen cell or oxygen sensor picks up, and the set FiO2 is the one command we give to the ventilator. The reasons could be there can be a problem with the blender, because actually the patient may be getting more oxygen, or there can be problem with the oxygen sensor. Actually, the patient is getting the set oxygen, but the sensor, because sensor is problematic, it is showing a different reading. So what you can do is you can use an FiO2 meter. If the actual FiO2 is actual means the delivered FiO2, sorry, the set FiO2 and actual FiO2 are same, it indicates that oxygen sensor is faulty. So you have to replace the oxygen sensor. If actual FiO2 is equal to delivered FiO2, then the blender is at problem. Like the FiO2 meter senses some FiO2 and the sensor senses some FiO2, and both are same. So the problem is with the blender. Before the sensor, the problem is there. There can be low pressure. This is because of pressure drop, which I have shown you in the demonstration, occurs because of problem with the central connections, but more commonly it occurs because of circuit leak or endotracheal tube leak. So for troubleshooting, you have to start at the patient end. You have to completely track the ventilator circuit, go to the ventilator and see where there is any leak. You can identify the leak in most of the situations. A leak alarm happens when the exhaled volume, the volume which is there in the expiratory limb, is less than inhaled volume by 20% or more. The reasons again are air trapping inside the lung or ET leak when the air is exhaling. For troubleshooting, you have to check the ET leak. You can check the adequacy of TE. If the TE is inadequate, there will be some air trapping. Okay, so you can see that in the flow time scaler. High pressure alarm indicates an increase in the circuit pressure. The various reasons could be the patient can be moving, because a moving child usually tries to create more negative pressure inside the pleura. There can be a high pressure which is generated in the lung. There can be some secretions, especially in the expiratory limb, which inadvertently increase the PWP. And there can be water in the secretions in the ET tube and water in the tubing, especially the expiratory limb. Sometimes there can be kinks in the tubing, which can result in significantly high pressures being delivered to the patient. For troubleshooting, you have to clear the ET secretions and clear the water in the expiratory limb. And if there is a kink in the expiratory limb, you have to correct it, because that can result in dangerously high pressures being delivered to the patient. Sometimes you see high respiratory alarm rate, like you set some respiratory rates, but the actual rates sensed by the ventilator are too high, then there will be an alarm. The reason could be underlying lung condition. Your settings may be inadequate to the lung condition. It may be poorly compliant lung or aspiration syndrome, and our set rates are very low. Then there will be tachypnea. Other causes could be the child is having fever or he is having pain. There is some metabolic acidosis, or there is some central nervous system reason because of which he is tachypneic. Or the load, the tidal volume set is low because of low PIP, low flow, or inadequate TI. Again, the child starts to breathe against the ventilator. Or there can be auto-triggering because of circuit leaks, fluid in the circuit, and very low threshold set for the triggering of the respiratory cycle. This can trigger the patient movement and cardiac beats and start delivering the breaths. So you have to rectify each and every cause. There can be dyssynchrony, which I will not be dealing in detail. It can be because of problems with the triggering, or problem with the flow, or problem with the cycling. So sometimes power alarm comes up when the power is not connected or the battery is discharged. So this can be an emergency, because this can result in shutdown of the ventilator. This has to be corrected immediately. And there can be some alarms in the humidifier also, which we commonly face. So a humidifier has 6 alarms, which I am showing in the red circles. So one is for the heater adapter, one is for the heater wire and the heater plate, the proximal temperature sensor, the distal temperature sensor, and the airway. So I will show you when these 6 alarms come and how to troubleshoot them. This is a short video in which I will demonstrate the heater temperature sensor and heater wire and adapter related alarms. So you can see when we are removing the heater wire, you can see the alarm getting activated. So if it is improperly connected or dysfunctional, the same alarm will come. The heater wire is disconnected, again the alarm will come. Both the heater area and the maximum temperature. So paid alarm will come when the problem is there.
Better to put
yes, two locations. Either they are loosely connected, properly connected, or they are dysfunctional. That situation, alarm will come. We also tried to activate the alarm of the temperature sensor, but it didn't get activated. I will tell you the reason why. So this is the alarm for heater wire connector. It occurs when the heater wire is not connected properly, or it is faulty, or there is some problem with the current flow. So we have to check the connection. If the connections are fine, still it is alarming, we have to replace the connector. So do not discard it. We have to hand back to our biomedical team and they will get it replaced. If there is a problem with the temperature or flow probe connector, this alarm will get activated. Again, you have to check whether it is faulty or whether it is properly connected. If it is properly connected, it means it is faulty and it has to be replaced. And there can be alarm coming in the chamber probe and airway probe together. So the reason could be either of them is dysfunctional or not properly inserted. Again, you have to replace the temperature sensors. Sometimes you, okay, the chamber probe can be activated with probe connector alarm. So this happens when the temperature probes are faulty. Again, you have to replace them. Sometimes the humidifier base, the region of the humidifier base starts alarming. The reason could be because of insufficient water. So when insufficient water is there, that can result in dangerously high temperatures, hence the humidifier starts alarming. So we have to ensure that water level is appropriate, and we also have to ensure, as I have shown in the demonstration, that the distilled water chamber should always be positioned above the level of the humidifier. It should not be positioned below the level of humidifier. That autofilling function which is there, that will be not utilized if you keep it below the level of the humidifier. And sometimes the temperature indicator occurs inside the airway. The reasons could be very high temperature or very low temperature inside the airway. High temperature is usually displayed when it is more than 41 degrees, and it starts alarming when it is more than 43 degrees. This can be dangerously high and damaging to the patient. Low temperature, this depends on the intensity. Like if it is below the set temperature for 25 seconds, the light starts blinking. If it is too long, it starts alarming. So how much time it takes, it depends on the threshold. Like if your set temperature is 37 and if it is 31 degree, the 6 degree difference, it will start alarming earlier. There is an algorithm. If the difference is only 1 to 2 degree, it takes a longer time to alarm. Thank you.
Thank you, Prasad. And so we don't have much time. So what we look, can you stop your screen share, please?
Yes.
We have one more last lecture, and this is again a practical session. For that, we want Dr. Sai to be ready. For all the people who want to continue attend the ventilation workshop, please mail to ajay.com.